Greetings, I am the Jaguar Knight. I review the movies so obscure the other reviewers on YouTube have never heard of them. This week's movie, I bring you Rio Negro from Venezuela, 1989. It means Black River. I fell deeply in love with this movie the moment I first saw it. Otherwise, I've only ever met one person who had seen it too. I couldn't rest until I would know how truthful this movie is, so I tried corresponding with people in Venezuela, only to drink deep at the well of disappointment all too often over 25 years. But it's different for you. You will get a good grounding in the true story behind this riveting movie. Rio Negro begins with some heart-starting examples of the delightfully raw and unvarnished Latin traditional songs that pepper this movie. And of the savage, intimidating, unknowable wilderness that besieged this scratch civilization in the jungle. This forcefully brings home just how remote this shithole is. And here's the director, Atahualpa Lishi. I wrote to him asking for insights into this movie, and he brutally snubbed me and arranged YouTube to give me a copyright strike. The new governor and entourage are journeying to his new, rather insalubrious hardship posting, the Amazonas Territory. And doesn't his beauty queen first lady look absolutely thrilled to bits with their new home? No doubt she's suitably impressed at the rather low-rent toilet facilities these canoes would have for a month-long journey. Now, take careful note of this on-screen disclaimer you're seeing. In other words, they've buggered it. First sight of their destination. Now, she wasn't expecting Florence, but the first sight of San Fernando de Atabapo knocks her for six. Oh sure, the good citizenry have turned out in numbers, but just look at the rest of the reception committee. You see, this town is dominated by a gang of extortionists led by a Teodosio Carrera, and a bunch of guys who otherwise are absolutely good for nothing. I mean, look at this one.
Toga! Toga!
Just what sort of a criminal record would he have anyway? I know, attempted taking of candy from a baby. And haven't we seen this one before?
Manamana. Manamana.
I'd say something smart-ass like, I think he's not our good guy. If this movie actually had a good guy. Our first falsification of the movie, Carreras appears to be a fictitious character. He doesn't turn up in any of the researches I've done in books or online. But at least one colourful character in this town is real life. Mark this name, mark the dress sense in black. Colonel Tomas Funes. And just when the governor is dancing the eternal dance of the politician, reassuring the public servants that they will keep their jobs,
Yo soy Francisco Suarez. Fui el secretario de su antecesor.
Lo ratifico en su cargo. Su experiencia me será de mucha utilidad.
Reality bubbles up to the surface.
Con quien tiene que hablar, gobernador.
Already we are impressed at how admirable the new governor can be as he tries to maintain his dignity, but the armed thugs tell him that they call the shots here. But this is one time when the bad guy wears the white hat. Certainly an eye-opening reception for the first family. For some reason, the new governor's name is Ricardo Osuna, but in real life it was Roberto Polito. Why must you change that? Is he going to sue you? He's dead! Spoiler alert, sorry. Here is the great man himself. I'll tell you more about him in episode 3.
¿A qué fiesta se refería Carrera?
A una fiesta en la Plaza del Pueblo.
¿Ah, sí? ¿Y
quién organiza la fiesta? ¿La gobernación?
No. Carrera. El hombre más poderoso de San Fernando.
I let them carry on with their pointless fabricated Carrera scenario while I point out how the movie gives away that it's a Swiftie. Just look at all these rifle-toting soldiers escorting them with rifles at the port. They're ready to mow those common thugs down. Why are they afraid of the common thugs? No, I don't know either how they fitted that giant chest in one of those canoes. This is the governor's palace and she straight up hates it. Now we set up the characters as motivations. She detests their sordid new posting, but he assures her, truthfully, that all he means to do is grow rich corruptly and then bolt to Paris. He urges her to join him in being the shining imperial couple who will provide an icon of class for the sullen subjects to admire. Her brother, Gilberto, is the only gay in the village. He is well-read and vivacious and determined to find some quality of life in this jungle backwater.
¿Dónde pongo los libros, cuñado? Quémalos.
Governor Osuna is a picture of overweening ambition and confidence. You just know those common thugs out there have picked a war with the wrong guy this time.
Qué amable de su parte, don Teodosio Carrera, darnos una fiesta. Don Teodosio Carrera. De mierda.
Al señor gobernador lo queremos saludar.
The ceremony is fiction, but a guilty pleasure.
En Amazonas se juntan la ambición y el ideal.
We see the common people go about enjoying their lives quite freely because the elites don't give a toss about them. You see, in this movie, elites battle other elites so much that the common people can just sail under the radar. Thank you, movie, for bringing back this lost world with all the inescapable rhythm and exuberance of Latin America. She's careful to put on a brave face. All acquitting themselves well, aren't they? All the actors in this movie are perfectly brilliant. Mostly unknowns. But this is a world ordered by the commonest of common thugs here to take what's theirs. This scene's a guilty pleasure, I say, because it's about the triumph of dignity over vulgarity, and we all love that.
Esos hombres están armados. Usted también, Carrera. No es correcto hacerlo en una fiesta pública.
Entonces quítemela.
Now these fuckwits impose their presumably deplorable personal hygiene on these lovely ladies who, by any reasonable standard, are a bit out of their league. Fictitious though I think he is, I love the fact that Carrera is a general, very authentic Venezuelan detail. I look forward to explaining that in part 3.
No te acerques!
Just think, if her husband is killed, she will have the same options as a piece of steak.
Te tendrá lo suyo, don Teodosio. Se lo prometo.
Ya usted tuvo su oportunidad.
Oh,
If you're not cheering by now, you're just not human. We're setting up the real theme of this movie, how regime change and how backing a liberator is backing the next tyrant.
Uno menos.
Here's one of the films regime change is already. It's always so kinetic, so interchangeable, such resignation on the part of the people being arrested and run like bulls. And precious little in the way of justice. Now, it may not have looked it to you, but this city is practically awash with money. And the reason is the rubber barons, the concessionaires, some of the most prominent being at this table here. It's all about rubber and Bellatar, you know, Bellatar, right? Even before the great boom ushered in by World War I, still the rubber trade is bringing in plenty of gold. But sooner or later, he has to get curious about that spectacularly aloof, black-clad figure in the background.
Señor Funes. Coronel Tomás Funes.
Funes admits that Colonel is a bit of a grandiose title for someone who commands 10 men, but he does keep order on the all-important plantations. Sorry, that's bending the truth. In real life, both Funes and Governor Pulido were rubber barons themselves.
Soy hombre de armas. Trabajo para estos señores y otros
propietarios. No, Funes's real-life role would be better comprehended if we were to telescope Carrera and thugs onto the plantations. Governor Pulido decides to go on a fact-finding tour of the rubber and Bellatar plantations and surveil his new domain, and hopefully figure out what the fuck Bellatar is.
No andar dando opiniones.
What they don't know is that this liberator is just cynically sniffing out ways in which he can personally plunder Rio Negro of as much gold as possible before pulling his great skedaddle for the outside world. He makes just the right pious noises about taxing them heavily at the orders of the government back in Caracas, who will get the money.
Para el gobierno. ¿Y eso qué es? Es el regatón de Juancho, que viene desde Manaos con las últimas novedades de París.
In this movie, the theme of Paris envy is never far away. He spots a cash cow that he yearns to milk dry. Here's a sharp dose of reality for him. This is a slave economy, revolving around the abduction of Indians from the neighboring jungles to toil in low survivability slavery. Here's one of the concessionaires with some Indian girls.
Todos ellos libres de impuestos.
Another crash course in reality is that Funes runs the show out here on the plantations. Now we learn that Funes is an ascetic who sets high standards for himself, including no booze. He decides to pimp his henchman, the young Gonzalito, onto the governor, so selflessly for mutual benefit. You'll be seeing a lot more of what appears to be the Terence Hill and Bud Spencer look-alike society later in the movie.
Este es el mundo en que se está criando ese muchacho. ¿Cómo se llama? Gonzalito.
Gonzalito, an Indian boy with both an inferiority complex and the sexual morality of a rutting jackrabbit, quickly becomes a pest as his impure interest in the First Lady becomes all too obvious.
Estará con interceptar. Y entonces, impuestos para ti, más impuestos para mí.
The governor strikes a body blow against the free and easy trade of the region by imposing the state, that means himself, as a middleman. The new tax goes into effect and immediately alienates those who generate all the wealth The governor is throwing away his aura of being a liberator.
Señor Freites.
He is alienating all those who matter and squandering the political capital he had built up as a liberator figure. But he is also delivering bread and circuses big time. Enter the Golden House, a brothel and casino ship with classy white whores for the better class of citizens. And yes, in real life, Governor Pulido really did institute this. I just love the fact that some of the women are celebrating this whorehouse arriving on their doorstep. Have they thought this through carefully? The Golden House transforms this sink into, well, a sleaze pit. Nothing rakes in money quite like gambling and prostitution. I mean, for the pimp. Yet, Governor Pulido doesn't let up on squeezing the merchants too. He wants all the money in this region. Gilberto, the only gay in the village, is trying to pick up anyone he can and glad of any intellectual company, which really can only mean Funes, who will never go homo in a million years.
Todo lo que ha caído en mis manos sobre la Revolución Francesa me lo he leído.
Yo puedo prestarle Michelet, los siete tomos.
Michelet? ¿Ese que ha escrito sobre la magia negra?
You bet your ass he did. Besides his magnum opus, you see it here, that Gilberto is offering to lend, he also wrote a work on the medieval witch craze, which I plan to make into an audiobook soon for this channel.
¿Será usted un Robespierre, coronel?
¿Espiando?
Gonzalito has disappointed his old father figure Funes by transferring his loyalties to the governor. Remember how he was meant to be spying for Funes?
No ve el uniforme.
Cría cuervos, te sacarán los ojos.
¿Qué dice mi coronel? Repita.
Gilberto still can't get lucky trying to find love, even trying for this savage.
¿Qué pasa?
And no, this one doesn't read French philosophers. Gonzalito's loyalty has been bought by giving him a uniform, a gun, and the feeling of being powerful and appreciated, even giving him whores, although he's not allowed the white ones. You see, this is a slaving expedition. Slavery is the other thing that powers the regional economy besides rubber. The slaves will be unlikely to survive their first rubber tapping season.
Hágase una trenza, Yari, como Raima. Así lucirá más limpia. No haga tanta bulla. A los blancos les gustan las mujeres silenciosas.
I applaud the realism of the fact that this creature, who pimps his own people into slavery, succeeds in earning only the thorough contempt of both sides. That is precisely the fate of traitors and collaborators anywhere in the world from the dawn of time. Very casual with those rifles. If the slaves rush them now, the troops won't get an aimed shot at them in time.
Siempre se puede hablar, ¿no?
When he sights Indians, Gonzalito indulges in target practice. He keenly encourages the merchants to try it too, something they find good sport. In this period, there was plenty of mindless cruelty in the troops serving the governors of San Fernando, and they didn't bother to count the Indians they killed. In that last scene, we learned that one girl has been reserved for special treatment.
¿Qué hace usted aquí? ¿Usted no se va?
Déjela ir. Ella ya tiene 13 años.
No se va. Usted no va a ser sirvienta. Está reservada.
And now it's time to find out what she was reserved for. For Funes, that's what.
Adentro.
Rápido.
Funes lives with his personal voodoo witch doctor, Macumba.
Despístete.
Her name is Nurami, and we'll be seeing a lot more of her. Told you, kept my promise. Oh no, I mean later in the movie. Frankly, her tribe is on a downward spiral to extinction. Sorry, one more thing. Amazon Indians don't have nearly that much pubic hair. The Golden House, floating flesh pot, becomes the place to be seen. The place where you look like you've made it. Even if Gonzalito can't hook up for love or money.
Que viva el señor gobernador!
Que viva!
The governor who bestowed this blessing, this two-fisted economic recovery strategy, is a hero for it. He indulges freely with the better class of prostitutes, the ones unavailable to the commoners and the coloured. And his wife finds out, which does their relationship no good at all.
Que no entiendo cómo no logras distinguir un pájaro que es una obra de arte de la naturaleza con un gallo espantoso de pena. Dicen que tampoco distingues unas mujeres de otras.
That's a bit harsh, because in all fairness, this chick would be a maniac in the sack. Gilberto, the only gay in the village, takes advantage of Gonzalito's sense of rejection, and, well, I thought about running this scene in soft focus to make it even more erotic. And now the surly loser who couldn't even score with a prostitute becomes effectively a prostitute by robbing Gilberto's wallet on the way out. This moral stain actually has the nerve to try to win on to the First Lady right now. Imagine the pickup line. Hey babe, I've just been butt-fucking your brother and haven't bothered bathing yet. How do you like me so far? Come on babe, let's get mounted. The Amazonas territory is so remote that the governor effectively rules by decree, paying lip service to the big dick. Tato back in Caracas. Here he graciously erects a bust to Gomez, while secretly stealing the monies meant for him. There's a portrait of Simon Bolivar, too, the founder of the Venezuelan state, and a statue of him today in this very spot. You never see a church or a judiciary in this movie, although there was a church right next to this spot, but any priesthood is powerless. Gonzalito becomes increasingly arrogant and predatory, forcing himself on the white Frenchwomen who he's not allowed to have. The closest thing this province has to a judicial system is the cockfighting arena. It is also the place to be seen if you are not in the brothel. Please note, I did not see a no animals were harmed message on this movie anywhere. It looks to me like some cockfighting birds are harmed in this movie, so please be aware in advance. The governor's bird has defeated Funes's bird. And Funes demonstrates that he has no use for any living thing that has failed him. For the governor, trade, like in this wonderful shop, exists only for him to fleece of every cent. And, true to history, conspiracy begins behind closed doors between the various wealthy men and Funes. Even toppling the governor by violent uprising is an option on the table. In one of the movie's most enjoyable scenes, we see Funes totally turn the tables on a rampaging Gonzalito, and it helps us to build a sense of why the merchants look up to Funes as their natural leader in the grassroots revolt.
Acuérdate de este día, Gonzalito. Acuérdate. No te lo voy a perdonar nunca.
Now the merchants write directly to Caracas, reporting all the tax they are paying, which shows up how much of it the governor is stealing.
Puesto mi cabeza que sobra de ese fúnebre.
It's time to redecorate the attack dog again.
Yo te nombro sargento mayor.
Tendré galones
y medallas.
He now forces the merchants to pay for everything in gold and silver, and provokes the same fatal backlash as China got when she tried to foist that on Britain in the Opium War. The new tax is scarcely distinguishable from straightforward confiscation. Gonzalito thrives on the sexy new uniforms and the opportunity to throw his weight around. This flashpoint brings on a confrontation with Funes, who has to enter the golden house that he hates so much, since that's where you can expect to find Pulido. Nice ass!
Su excelencia está ocupado en este momento.
But Polito's corruption has taken over his soul by now. He cannot be reasoned with anymore, and he can't tell that he is provoking rebellion with his policies anymore.
El oro es sagrado en Río Negro. Esa ley es un saqueo.
Y da sus palabras cuando hablé conmigo, Funes.
Funes lays his cards on the table. It's rebellion.
Usted y yo. No existe acuerdo posible.
Coronel Funes!
It's all setting up the climactic but fictitious cockfight sequence.
Usted jugador. Entonces que los gallos decidan.
But the cockfight has a predetermined outcome.
Hombre muerto.
You're looking at Funes's training montage scene for the coming fight. Yes, that's right, a voodoo ritual for the bird. And we get to see his Indian concubine, Nurami, again. Funes's voodoo is the only religion we ever see in this movie, but I can't find it in the historical record.
Gracias, Ochoz.
He now carries his lawyer to, well, the law courts. The look he flashes to Nurami says, farewell, because a very different man will come home. I love the way everyone in the street closes their doors and windows as he's approaching, whether because they're afraid of his voodoo or because he's dead man walking. But look at the name of this street. La Previsora, which just happens to be the name of the insurance company used in this movie-making project. Here's an ad for what is still a going concern. Their logo shows their huge skyscraper in Caracas. Enjoy a rare moment of elegance in this movie. The ladies aren't allowed to go to the cockfight, you see. You know what that is across the river? It's a foreign country. Colombia is directly across the river from the capital of this province. Even the ladies of the Golden House are not welcome in the cockfighting arena.
Aquí se prohíbe la entrada de mujeres. Son pavosas, dan mala suerte.
Esas son habladurillas. En Francia también hay galleras.
But we can well imagine how disappointed the whores must have been to learn that the fighting's being done with birds for some reason. Gotta hand it to this governor, he sure does come up with some great 50-year out-of-date uniform styles to purchase Gonzalito's loyalty with.
Preparado, coronel?
Usted quiera, gobernador.
With the governor's bird clearly winning, he can't help getting just a bit cocky. Suddenly, Funes activates the voodoo protection, and his bird becomes the Terminator. And I'd have to say, probably kills the other bird on screen. Sorry, folks. Having determined in advance to kill Funes no matter what the outcome, the governor is now forced to expose his rotten soul to public glare. Fuck, that was boss, Coronel. Obviously, they've been rehearsing this, completely outwitting the late governor. And Funes' coup is in full swing. All those loyal to Pulido are dragged out of their homes, run like bulls, and mostly killed, mostly with machetes. And of course, people who they owe money, just like any revolution. But Gonzalito, sadistic maniac though he is already losing interest in power politics. If you were wondering just what Funes used to entice him to change sides, well, that would be her now. At last, that icon of regal femininity, the late governor's widow, is his for the taking. Sorry folks, it's a rape scene, and quite a graphic one. I will spare you the rape scene. The fiends kill her children and pack rape her. Funes's coup has taken somewhere over 130 lives, by machete mostly. Mercedes, yes, that was her name, never used in this movie, wanders like a ghost through the carnage. She has become a madwoman, hanging around on the fringes, a living advertisement for Funes's raw power, and no one dares to speak to her. Already, the top concessionaires are having second thoughts about the liberator they've backed. Were you, too, seeing him as a righter of wrongs? Who you would follow into a revolution? I confess I was, first time. That's what this movie is all about. The tendency of a liberator to become the next oppressor.
Me lo vas a chupar en el cielo.
¡Gonzalito!
Este hombre es inocente. Lo necesito a mi lado.
Don Tomás, usted es un César, el Mesías, el enviado de Dios.
Don't worry, you can talk to him like that. It won't go to his head. Halftime report, folks. I have shown you the Funes coup in some detail, but before I show you the Funes regime, 1913 to 1921, let me tell you how the coup really went historically. Here is Funes's house as shown in the movie. Here it is in real life, before it was demolished in the 1950s. The conspiracy started here. The coup forces marshaled in here. Here is the great man himself, trying to look like a respectable merchant. In fact, he was a merchant, but in his past he had been a high-ranking officer in two civil wars. And here is the shockingly corrupt governor who he overthrew and killed, Roberto Pulido, obviously a former officer too, though that is not even hinted at in the movie, where he is relentlessly civilian. Here is the government house, as it was many years after the tumult of 1913. Here is the street in which Funes's victims were massacred on that appalling night. Yes, night. Poor as the photographic record is, I'd say the movie has done a good job of reproducing this lost world of old San Fernando. Here are some of the victims of Funes's coup, killed within a week of the start of it all. All the men in one family, the Espinosas. This is a newspaper article of the time about the drama of Rio Negro and, more bitingly, the crimes of Rio Negro, the nefarious deeds of Funes and Gonzalez, as recorded in a contemporary newspaper. But sadly, this guilty pleasure showdown at the cockfight scene is complete fiction. Here's what Funes really did. He gathered a large number of plantation workers, skilled in the use of machetes, and marshaled them secretly in San Fernando town, in his house or in the houses of their own bosses. He made them roll up their left sleeves for recognition. He waited until the governor returned to the town on his boat at nightfall. Yes, all this should have happened at night time. They quietly removed all the canoes from the waterfront to inhibit escape of their intended victims. Then they rushed the governor's palace and attacked him with the machetes. He fought bravely, using his Winchester rifle, but they overwhelmed him and killed him. One witness did report seeing Gonzalez in the city that night, killing people on a boat like a production line, coming in one side and being dumped out the other. He probably took that boat immediately northwards to attack Atures. Here, Gonzalez attacked Pulido's family. Her ladyship Mercedes was raped and passed around. But her ultimate fate is controversial. Her brother Gilberto Laja was seized, defenestrated, and ultimate fate also unknown. Funes did use Avispa and Picure, but the movie is wrong to show them in the same location as Gonzalito / Gonzalez. He quickly went away to attack the faraway city of Atures, where he got the rest of the governor's family. The soldiers found Mercedes tied up after Gonzalez had raped her, and they gang-raped her. Gonzalez then came back and raped her again. Whether one or both of her children were murdered is unclear. Likewise, it is unclear whether she suicided in the river shortly after the massacre, or whether she lingered a long time, as the movie shows. We then see Gonzalez raid a city, San Carlos, that in fact he never raided. That was Luciano Lopez. Already the vast Amazonas territory was being turned into a hell on earth.
Fernando está dominado.
Aterrorizado. Thank you for watching this humble one-man project this far. Please join me for part 2, The Funes Regime, and part 3, The Characters. Good night from the Jaguar Knight.